The slave trade developed in this triangular form out of initially Spanish and Portuguese merchants taking Africans to the Atlantic Islands. When they needed a labor force in places like Brazil and the Caribbean, it was almost a natural extension to take Africans who they didn't regard as the same as themselves. They didn't see them quite as full human beings. There was slavery in Africa before Europeans arrived, but I think it was a different sort of slavery. It's sometimes described as a more domestic type slavery. It's where slaves were often part of the household, and they weren't treated with the same degree of brutality, of violence, of really being dehumanized. In the form of slavery that we're talking about in the Americas, what we now call chattel slavery, people had their names taken away from them.
I have with me a document from the slave register in St. Kitts, and this shows a list of the names that were given to the Africans. Their African names were removed. And one of these names is Nobody. He's written down, a 14-year-old boy, his job is to look after the cattle, and he's written down as Nobody. I've seen other names like this too, like Gift or Property.
The slave trade developed out of the need for labour in the Americas to grow sugar, and it developed into what was known as the triangular trade. And ships from places like Liverpool went out to the coast of West Africa taking goods, which were then traded on the coast for enslaved Africans.
The picture we're looking at here shows Liverpool at the beginning of the slave trade in 1725. Already we have the first dock built in 1715, and we have the customs house in 1722. The warehouses that were built here stored the tropical goods that were brought over in the ships. These were the ships that had travelled on the transatlantic route.
The Middle Passage took about 6 to 8 weeks under normal circumstances. One of the voyages that we know about was in a ship called the Zong, which was a Liverpool ship, which left Liverpool in 1780. And the captain had a problem on board, that he had a number of his enslaved Africans who were very sick and they were dying. And he knew that the more slaves who died, the less the profit was going to be for his owners and for himself. So that he thought, well, if they die from other causes, then I can claim insurance. So that he told the rest of the crew that they were running short of water and suggested that they throw some of the Africans overboard. And over 3 days, they threw overboard 130 Africans. And then when the ship got back to England, they claimed insurance on those enslaved Africans. And that led to a court case. But the insurers lost. I think the case of the Zong was very unusual, but I don't think that should stop us really remembering that the Middle Passage was a very brutal and difficult experience for enslaved Africans.
Leg irons like these were used to stop any African slaves from moving around. As you can see, that would be hammered into there by a blacksmith once the foot had been put through. These were absolutely necessary in places like the Middle Passage, where you had slaves who were struggling to be free, which they were at all times. I think we tend to forget that, you know, that these people were fighting every step of the way.
We know of many cases where some of the Africans preferred to jump overboard to commit suicide rather than stay on board the vessel. We also now know that there was an attempted insurrection, attempted revolt by by the Africans on about 1 in 10 voyages.
If you look at images of a plantation, you might think they look really rather beautiful and grand. If you look beyond the plantation to the cane field, if it's a sugar plantation, you'll see the cane, which is a lime colour, a little bit like bamboo, and it's about 11 feet high, waving gently in the wind and running down to the cobalt blue sea. And you could believe that you were in paradise, but for the enslaved Africans, this was a nightmare. Enslaved Africans were worked beyond endurance, and the death rate shows that a third of them died during what we call seasoning. This was the period where the enslaved Africans, when they first arrived, were so-called accustomed to their new life. This was a euphemism, this was a word made up to describe the obliteration of the African's will. If you go around the gallery, you will see images of muzzles, of whips, of shackles, and of other instruments of torture. And these were used in order to break the will of the enslaved Africans.
This is called a punishment collar. It was used on plantations. If a slave ran away and was caught, when they came back to the plantation, they were put into one of these as a punishment. It would go around the neck, and it would be padlocked at this point here. The idea is it holds your head forward, and so you can see to work. What you can't do is run, because it's fused your spine at the top. This whip would be a lady's whip. This would be a very nice Christmas present or birthday present, which should have been given to the lady of the plantation. Now, she would use this in the house. Obviously, it's much too short to be used in the field. It's very, very short. It's only just over a foot long. But she would use it to keep the house slaves in order.
The Maroons were a group of runaway slaves that set up a community in the interior of Jamaica. They fought against the occupiers of the island in what would be referred to as guerrilla warfare. They would have, over successive generations and hundreds of years, have the community would have grown, and this was a form of like resistance and rebellion. So though 1807 celebrates the end of the slave trade, it's not the end of people being enslaved.
In the 18th century, the slave trade was just another trade, I think, for most merchants and people involved in trading. They just saw it as a different sort of cargo. And that to us nowadays, I think, is quite incomprehensible. And we just cannot understand how people could treat fellow human beings in such a brutal and inhuman way.